involves doing required physical rehab. So one of the pieces is to do, you know, an appraisal on the property, and then to do inspections and a list of what kind of capital improvements are needed. And that's always part of the deal here. So in just in general, Mass Housing estimates that, you know, in general, $30,000 per unit is put into the kind of deal. Of course, that varies on the particular state of these units. So other things that are involved are the MRVP contracts. So those are the project-based subsidies that go with the low-income units, and the state financing that we talked about, and local funds. Those are your major pools of money. The next slide jumps to public benefit from the local contribution. And we've touched upon this, promoting the diversity of housing stocks, forbearing income limits, housing for local workforce, protecting the rent for existing tenants, because of course it's hard to find comparable housing in Bedford, and local funds very much strengthening the deal. There's a lot of leveraging that the state is looking for, and when we get into it, there's a lot of preservation opportunity that the town would have with the more money, like how many units are being preserved to what income level and what rent level.
Mm-hmm. And would that, would the use of local funds be able to demand a permanent deed restriction based?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So that
there
you would no longer have
deed
okay.
restriction on any deal that comes forward.
Okay.
But certainly with the local funds, yes.
Good. Thank you.
If the property goes to market in 2021, there'd be some impact on those 24 market goal units that we talked about, because those really aren't at market, so presumably those would go to market. The low-income units on the MRVP, those would move to a slightly higher MRVP rent increase, what we call here the tax credit rents. And of course, then the larger impact is on the 50% of the units, those 48 13A units. And you could see here for the two-bedroom, their current rent is $1,030, and if they went to market, it's an $820, you know, complete estimate, but given what we are estimating to be what the market rent would be. So that's a huge impact. Looking forward, what a hypothetical preservation deal might look like. As we mentioned before, the low-income units would stay low-income, as that's how they, the comprehensive permit 25% would be satisfied. The market goal units would go to real market, and the 13A units would be preserved, and maybe preserved to the tax credit level. Again, that's a standards that we can get into. It's a 60% AMI level, and it would look like that kind of thing. So for a two-bedroom, instead of an 800 increase, it would be a 200 increase. So still some impact, but so these are the elements, of course, that can be discussed depending on local contribution and what kind of funds are available. Here there is an example. It's hard to find exact examples of a project in Cambridge that preserved some number of units. And I'm not going to, in the interest of time, just go through that. You can sort of see. In terms of using CPA funds, right, every project is different, and these projections could easily vary. We don't know the extent of the capital needs of the project. We don't know the extent of the state funding available, you know, any kind of things.
We don't know how much it'll appraise for.
Mm-hmm. Right. So CPA can plug the gap if the state funders run low. It could provide a deeper subsidy for some of the units, as we talked about, and it could convert some of those market rate units to affordable. So you could get more units to be affordable, some units to be deeper affordable, and it could just fill the gap in general for the deal if there's not enough money to make it happen. And it could be used to fund property improvements in excess of what the funders would typically fund. So any number of ways that the CPA funds could be put in. How much CPA? It's really, without the elements of the deal or any of this known, it's hard to say. So we say here, $2 million or more. I think that you could go up to $3 million. You could go higher. I really don't know. But we put a sort of placeholder here of $2 million or more using that Cambridge example.
which it's hard to say if that's an entirely, you know, similar example to Bedford. And the next steps would be continue to reach out to the agencies, reach out to the owner, and then to consider the CPA fund allocation, because I know that, you know, with the annual CPA process, at least to get something in discussion, because there is some amount of money that will be useful to have in this kind of project. And the deals, as I say, like, are short, so you might not have enough time to go back for another round of CPA funding for when it's available.
Thanks so much. Who wants to start the question?
I'll ask a few. Is the owner, the current owner, allowed to sell the property for anything she can get?
Yes.
And,
yes.
Yes. I heard yes. Who is it that is, in your mind, supposed to be reaching out? Who is it that should be trying to get the owner to come to the conclusion that might be best for Bedford?
Well, Rick has done a good job of reaching out to the undersecretary. Is he the undersecretary?
No, secretary. Secretary Ash.
Secretary Ash, thank you.
Yep.
DHCD and Mass Housing have reached out and have been waiting to hear. I think it might be more like that.
We did have a meeting with the owner and her top deputy earlier this year, and you know, made our the town's, along with the town being at the meeting, the town's interest very clear.
We thought we were going to meet last week or the week before, but her health prevented her from attending or rescheduling.
So should the town be looking for a potential developer? Should, I mean...
No.
There's nothing a developer could do, because she owns the property.
I understand.
Yeah.
But in the private market, developers come forward and make offers and say, would you be interested in considering this?
Well, DHCD holds the right of first refusal.
And they're not going to say anything until she says they want to sell? I can see how this could get very jammed up into a very short period of time.
A question. I wanted to ask, I'm sorry, go ahead, Mary.
No, that's okay. I just had a clarifying question about the use of the community preservation funds, because as you know, the community preservation funds can be used for workforce housing up to 110% of AMI. 100. Oh, 100. Oh, okay. I'd seen 110. So in that case, would there be an opportunity to convert some of those near market units back to affordable if we chose to structure it that way?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. You could see on that one, I know I went through all of this very quickly, the use of CPA that's on slide 22. So it's really the last people. So CPA could be used to provide a deeper subsidy for existing affordable units,
okay,
convert some of the market units to affordable, which I think is what you're talking about, or fund property improvements in excess of what the state funders are looking at.
Okay.
Those are the three major areas.
Is there an interest rate on that $100 million that the DHCD has to available to preserve units?
Yeah, that would be that's soft money. So the way these deals are put together is there's a think of it as a stack, and at the bottom of the stack is an actual mortgage at market, you know, interest rates, supported by the rental structure
through private sources or through the state.
Probably through Mass Housing, but it'll be, you know, closer to 4, 5, 6%, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
X amount of money. The $100 million we're talking about here is what's known as a soft debt. So it's real money, but there's not a debt service attached to it. There might be an interest rate, but only for tax and depreciation sort of maneuvering.
So no real repayments?
No payments. As long as it's the hook that the regulators have over an owner to make sure that they charge the rents, because if they comply, that they comply with it. If they don't, it's like, okay, you know, start paying on $10, $20 million. It's very effective.
So there are a number of people here who are quite concerned, and there's more here who are not here who are also concerned. So I have a couple of questions along those lines. Do you think we need to make some kind of a statement or a vote or something that says that we're going to pursue this? I mean, we can't commit to it. We don't have the numbers, but at least reassure people that we want to preserve the status quo, if we can afford to.
That's up to the pleasure of the board.
I mean, well, I don't know what's done in other towns that are confronting this, but I just want to send a message to the tenants that says that we're going to try to. We can't say, yeah, we're going to do whatever it takes, because we don't know, but that we're going to try to respond and in an effort that we agree with all of the goals that you set forth in terms of diversity, in terms of local workforce, in terms of all of the advantages of maintaining the status quo. I just want to make sure that the tenants know that we're on their side in this. We're not just standing back to see what happens. But if you don't think it's necessary to do a formal vote, I don't hear anybody disagreeing.
I'm not saying no, but I don't think that. I mean, I can say yes. I think you should. But I think that would be a great idea.
I mean, I guess in similar circumstances, have the executives of other communities gone on record in anticipation of an expiring use as saying that they would pursue it? I mean, I guess the first opportunity to take a vote about something would be if community preservation came forward with a proposal to appropriate funds towards a potential project at Bedford Village, then not only would the selectmen, but the whole town would have an opportunity to vote on
it. Which is what it comes down to.
So in Concord, we're working on a project in Concord that requires a significant local contribution, and the select board in Concord took a number of support votes just to be sure to have that on record, and everyone would know that, you know, the board voted on this day in support of the project. In addition to sponsoring a CPA, and they also sponsored a free cash article, you know, in addition to that, where they sponsored that and it's on the warrant coming up. So really, it's those two actions, okay, as you mentioned.
I suppose that the selectmen could actually maybe take a vote to instruct staff in cooperation with the RHSO office to develop a project request form for FY18's community preservation budget.
I would make that motion.
I'll second that.
Moved by Margaret and seconded by Caroline to prepare the project request form in connection with expiring use. But what that represents, I think, is the statement that says that we're moving forward with an affirmative action that says that the town wants to be involved. Any discussion?
So the only thing I don't quite know is what we would use for a number in a request form, because as soon as I can tell, we don't really have any sense of the numbers at all. I mean, the Cambridge example.
Numbers, and so we had 2 million or more. I think there might be, you know, some potential for including more if you wanted to think about $3 million as well, you know, but there's no specifics. We don't have any project budgets, for example, to share with you what that would look like.
Yeah, because I'm sorry, so some of the materials are just slightly confusing. The Cambridge project is pegged at $66 million. The only number you've used in here is the potential for $30,000 a unit, which really is only $3 million. Mm-hmm. I know that the Cambridge number is a total development cost number and the other is simply a rehabilitation number, but it's hard to get to $3 million at the Bedford level when you've got only a potential rehab number and a 20 times that for the Cambridge example. So I am fully supportive of making sure that we know and that the community knows that we have resources that we want to help. I'm just slightly concerned that we don't peg too many numbers to it, because we just don't know. We don't know what the appraised value is. We don't know. She could say, I'm not going to do it, but I'm not selling it to anybody else. The company will continue to own it in some way. I don't know. So they may not, be a transaction number.
It's an educated guess. It's a planning number. Right. Here's an order of magnitude that's important to start with, so that, you know, all of these are big numbers to appropriate through that process. And
So just to start someplace that's significant so that you're able to make some progress when the project comes forward.
And I would just reassure that the Community Preservation does accept applications mm-hmm. that have ballpark but educated estimates, and then as the process moves forward, those numbers have to be substantiated and refined, and obviously it also is dependent upon the amount of funds that Community Preservation has available to allocate towards it. So being able to plan for an impending but not certain expenditure of a certain amount is helpful, more helpful than not, and waiting until later in the game to say, oh, by the way, we want $2.5 or $3 million.
The reason why we scheduled this tonight is so that you would be all educated and informed about this, mm-hmm. since we do anticipate making some kind of request in time for the public mm-hmm. hearing process of CPA. And I will also say that in the phone conversations I've had with some state officials and Mass Housing about this project, that I've made them aware of our schedule as a town and with a town meeting that has to adopt a warrant, and that there are only so many windows of opportunity for us to work on putting together funding requests like this. So hopefully they understand that, and we'll have a meeting soon with the parties involved. Unfortunately, as Liz said, the health of the owner was apparently got in the way of a meeting happening in the last couple of weeks that we had hoped to have.
All those in favor of the motion for the application to the Community Preservation Fund?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. 500. I also wanted to ask whether the Housing Partnership has any role in terms of being on the point for this issue?
Well, this presentation has already been discussed at the Housing Partnership mm-hmm. meeting. They're aware.
Refined and improved because of it?
I'm sorry, say that again.
Oh, and it was refined and improved
yes,
because of those
through that review process, yes. So they're certainly aware of this and supportive of it so yeah. far.
Mm-hmm. And we've offered, if helpful, to come to the CPC and to help go through this.
I think that will be helpful.
It is a significant amount of money that might require some bonding or some financing options, to whatever extent that we can provide this background.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask at this time if anyone in the neighborhood had any questions or comments on this issue. Sure. Just state your name for the record.
My name's Paula Hill. I live over at Bedford Village. We had a meeting this past summer, and from what I'm listening to right now, we're still in the same place. Nobody's got, the owner hasn't made up her mind, and nobody seems to push the owner. She got an attorney. Why can't they get something concrete, or even maybe? And it's like, so we're still sitting in the same place. And now, this was like 2016, we're finished with that. 2017, and next year, you know, we'll be in 2018, and we're still looking for another place to live. Now, it doesn't sound like anybody's going any place. But the only one's gonna be out of anything is the tenants.
Liz, can you provide any reassurance?
Well, we've been in touch with the owner and her lawyer and her consultant to make sure that they fully understand that the town is extremely interested in moving this project forward. And we had a meeting scheduled with the state agencies that was canceled on account of her health just last week. So
what I'm saying now is that you guys can't, you can't make a decision until you get something concrete. Now, you can plug in any number and still come up with, you don't know until something happens. Mm. Something concrete has not happened yet. So if you can't do it this way, maybe you're going to find a different way of approaching it. You know, because, 2017 is not going to sit around and wait for us.
Thank you. I think we hear what you're saying, Christina.
I'm speaking only as a resident. I was about to say that a lot of people are already in panic mode. And in speaking with someone in Cambridge Housing Office that was involved with the Briston Arms deal, that isn't it an exact match? When it was a federal program, it's a state program, that's a little bit larger program. Cambridge is, I don't know if there's a better city or town that takes retaining their residents more seriously than Cambridge. They've been doing a lot of work on that. And in speaking with them, and Bill Browner, I think they pronounced his name, I was told that, you know, you can reach out, and they are trying to reach out, and you can try to
Preservation of affordable housing is one of the, there's a number of entities that specialize in purchasing these type of developments with the idea of preserving them and continuing to run them as affordable housing. It's a large niche within the affordable housing industry, and we're fortunate that some of the bigger players are located in Boston.
So what I was going to say is, I think it was Briston Arms or maybe another development that they were actually proactively reaching out to the preservation builder or developer in hopes that when it was decided by the DHCD, whoever builds it out, DHCD, that they would say, oh, you already have, you've got some relationship here, you've got some funding put together, you're looking at this seriously, we're going to give you more attention. Now she said, you can't guarantee that will guarantee that you'll get that developer, because who they assign to you is who they assign to you. But it's a worthwhile effort trying to find somebody who's good to work with, which shows a serious intent. And in the Briston Arms example, I think the city of Cambridge gave something like $4.5 million, and they were able to, I think it's 154 units. They were able to increase the number of units that were affordable, and they rationalized and made a little less expensive for many the rent system. There were a couple of people who were paying, a couple of units that were paying super low, and they had a little slight increase. But they were able to do everything they could to be able to retain the people that are already living there. And there's already been upward pressure on the rents at Bedford Village. It's my understanding that Mass Housing has been asked Bedford Village to you know, try to increase the rents as within certain limits, I understand, but that upward pressure has been happening for the last couple of years. And when I was speaking with Bill Brown, it was a great deal of experience in this. I explained to the 96 units, et cetera, and when the housing was built, et cetera, and he said, you know, $3 million is a good guess. He says it may be more. It may be a little less, but he says $3 million is a good figure, a realistic figure. But again, their situation is federal, so they have different pockets of money that they can access. This is a state level, so it's not quite the same. And there had been legislation that didn't make it last term pushing for more affordable housing. But what the governor did is he kicked in that half of that $100 million to support this these 13A projects. So I just wanted to communicate that little bit of information that I gained and let you know that people are very, very concerned about it. And I think we need to think a lot about trying to save people that live there, making it so they can stay in the community. And I know there was some discussion, at least by one party, of changing the MRVPs from site-specific to be non-site-specific. And I don't think that's a wise move. I think that helps the state say, oh, we don't have to give you as much, because you're not only taking care of these people for sure. And I think it sort of makes it sound for the people who have those site-specific vouchers that they're really just it anyway. Just, you know, move to, you know, East Overshoot. But I think you'll find a lot of people in Bedford Village are really tied to Bedford. A lot of the kids are in the school system, and they bring a lot to the town.
There are people in Bedford Village, and I don't know if they live in market rate or affordable or what level, but I do know that they've lived here their entire life. They grew up here, and they're still here. Not that that makes any difference, we love them all. But the, but I think the first thing that we have to do is have this meeting.
Yes.
I mean, we can speculate all night, but I wanted to just say how fortunate we are that we have the RHSO to be up front with us for this.
And I wanted to mention too that Aaron Gornstein, who ran DHCD for a long time, is now runs the POA, the Preservation of Affordable Housing Organization, and we've mentioned this project to him just so that his organization is aware that maybe it's coming. So.
Awesome. Yeah. So I know that Christina will keep this on the front burner on behalf of the Housing Partnership, because she's been talking about it for about 5 years,
right,
and here we are. So it certainly isn't going to slip through the cracks. Meanwhile, thank you for your vigilance in making sure that we're using all of the resources we have to make a case for. Any other questions?
No.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sure. Yep, you're welcome.
Thank you. Before we move on to the capital expenditure recommendation, I wanted to make a suggestion with the board's consent and Mr. Battaglia. We have an agenda item at 8:30 that is of interest to a number of people. I don't think it's going to take very long, whereas the capital expenditure presentation could take a while. I wonder how you'd feel about dealing with the Safe Routes to School agreement and then the cemetery regulations. Try to wrap that up in about 12 minutes and then move on to the capital expenditure without having to have people.
I think that's a good idea.
But I don't want to inconvenience you either.
Thank you.
Can we talk about the, this says 8:25, it's 8:23, but it's actually 8:21. This is a state requirement to commit to certain considerations with state control in connection with the proposed signalized intersection at Mudge Way and Great Road. Mr. Reed, this seems to be addressed to you.
Hold on a second, Mr. Chairman. Could you see if the DPW director or engineer are out there, Mike? Thanks.
Oh, right.
I believe they may be expecting to be here when this.
Yeah, I thought they might.
There we go. Oh,
yeah. You make anybody else appear? Got the TV.
David, we're ready to do the traffic control agreement for the Safe Routes to School project. So, as selectmen know, the town is the beneficiary of some state and federal funds to improve the intersection of Great Road and Mudge Way. This was on the Transportation Improvement Program for FY16, and it was advertised before the end of the federal fiscal year 16, which committed the funds. Project went out to bid, and construction is due to start this coming spring sometime. Because these improvements are on a municipal right-of-way or in municipal property, to utilize the federal and state funding, we're required to enter into this traffic control agreement with the state government to ensure that the regulations that will be necessary for signal turns and signage to be in compliance with federal and state standards for transportation control measures are actually followed. So you have this draft traffic control agreement, and you're asked to consider approving it and authorize the town manager to execute the agreement for the town.
Okay, Margaret.
So the only question that I had, and I understand sort of conceptually why the state wants to do this, but there's one paragraph on traffic control signals, and it says the traffic control signal shall be operated in strict accordance with the requirements of the applicable permit. So if I understood what I read there, it means that the state's going to permit the signal to operate in a certain way. The town will be responsible for making sure that it operates in the way that the state wants it to operate. But I guess my question is, we've had experience with signal timings being off or not conducive to the flow of traffic or making it hard for pedestrians to cross or whatever problem it might be. In the past, when those signals have been controlled by the state, I think it just makes it all the harder to be flexible or to adjust when there's a problem that presents itself. So do you have any concern about that particular area of this agreement in terms of what happens if we, after specking out the signal and doing our best, you know, analysis of how it should be timed, that if it needs to be retimed, is that an arduous process to get the state's permission to change it?
I think we do have some concerns. It is slightly different than the way the permits have been approved in the past, particularly as we look to change traffic flow along the Great Road. These signals will continue to have different flow patterns. So I think as part of the permitting process, we're just going to need to work very closely with the state and make sure we can, as quickly as possible, get them here to keep up with the changes.
So the answer is if we did need to change it, then we would have to go ask them and they would have to come out and do some sort of analysis of whether or not our problem was justified a change.
Exactly. And I think following the permit process, there's some standard analyses that can be done, and hopefully we can help them with that to get the ball rolling more quickly.
Okay. So that was my only concern.
I thank you for providing this layout of signage. A lot of this is occurring in the historic district, and signs are proliferating like bunny rabbits, and it is not attractive in terms of the historic district. I certainly want the route to be safe and properly signed for that regard. This is probably a follow-on to the exact same question, different version. If there's any ability to reduce the number of signs in any way, it would, particularly on the Great Road. I'm not so worried in Mudge Way as I am right along the historic district corridor on the Great Road. It surely would be a wonderful thing. I know our hands are severely tied, but I don't think we should not ask the question, because if you don't ask, you don't get. And so I'd really like to see that done. Speak on behalf of the town of Betsy.
Other question? Dave, do you know if the parking restrictions in front of the Stearns building, in front of the police station, does that basically just replicate what's there now, or is it extended farther? It says 275 feet east of the intersection.
I'm not sure about that. I can take a look, though.
I think because basically the Great Road is being narrowed in that area there, that we are reducing parking that's presently available to be had on the street today. That's part of the overall design of the Great Road Master Plan.
Mm.
I think that's correct, and mm-hmm. That definitely came up in the MassDOT public hearing, the concerns particularly about the Congregational Church mm-hmm. Losing the on-street parking that it currently has access to, and you know, retaining a few spaces, and I think the state made some alterations there, but I think overall the parking is going away.
Yeah, and but that was understood.
Yeah, that was made clear definitely in that meeting. That was definitely a very point of great interest for the abutters.
Do you know about the new, I see this, and I see this as on here also, and it doesn't seem to be universal, but now in some signalization, I see that flashing amber on the left turn. That's being retrofitted or at all, or is just on new signals?
I think it's being retrofitted.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess it's kind of self-explanatory. But I, I'm starting several places in Lexington. Other questions about the agreement?
So is there a timetable? I mean, obviously, I know that this is pretty much imminent, and but if Selectman Moonen and I have a few concerns or questions that need to be posed to the state, is there a time to get those answered before we have to sign this agreement? I mean, for example, about the number of signs along the roadway, or must we essentially sign it?
I think we're pretty much there that it's time to sign it, unfortunately. But certainly as we continue to look at the master plan.
The signage is what federal transportation standards, which Massachusetts follows, is what the statute and the standards prescribe. I'm sure, I know the state would not want to pay for additional signage if they didn't have to put it up to be in compliance with the federal standards. Mm. So I think the signage is what it needs to be in compliance with the standards.
So if we're ready for a motion to authorize the town manager to sign the traffic control agreement.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Margaret and seconded by Caroline. Authorize the town manager on behalf of the selectmen to sign the MassDOT traffic control agreement for the safety improvement project. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 With unhappiness, aye.
500.
Thank
you. The block, don't block intersection sign right on Wilson Park. That seems to be totally superfluous.
Well, maybe if we redo Wilson Park, we'll have to get
I'll
rid
have,
of it.
I'll discuss it with you some other place and time.
This next agenda item is about a proposed regulation update for new sections of the Shawshing Cemetery. Mr. Freeman.
So, Mr. Chair, and members of the board, recently a Public Works Department completed the expansion or the ability to expand and create a new area in the cemetery for burials. And the selectmen are the commissioners of Shawshing Cemetery and established the rules and regulations for the cemetery, which include the identifying the various sections of the cemetery and establishing the fees that are charged for each of those secretaries. So before we can begin to sell any of the planned new areas in the cemetery, the selectmen need to vote to amend the cemetery regulations. So we have proposed a through the ground manager's efforts amendments to the cemetery regulations for your consideration. And you have a plat in front of you showing you the area where the new sections would be.
So we're basically just changing the price structure, right?
Yeah, what's different about this from other things, it's new, is that there's a special area within the new area for just the burial of cremains. And so these particular graves, they're smaller than the traditional grave, and they would be sold just for the purposes of cremated remains burial.
And these, congratulations to Dennis and his group for preparing these new sections. These sections will not support granite markers, right?
Correct.
Questions on this plan from Selectman?
So the size of a cremation lot is 4x4?
Correct.
Whereas the size of an ordinary plot is 4x8? And like in Lexington, you'll be able to put a granite marker flush with the ground?
You'll be able to do a
bronze
marker, whether it's bronze or granite.
Correct. It's very attractive. It makes mowing easy.
When will the new section be open and available?
As soon as this
meeting?
Rules and regulations are amended.
Okay. No questions.
They don't have to be approved by the Attorney General. Just us. Any other questions? Seems rather straightforward.
Well, I'd like to make the motion to approve the Shawshing Cemetery expansion, which includes new plots in two sections, 200 single graves in the Ridge section, additional 300 cremation lots in the Ridge Cremation Garden, as shown on the attached plan and in this memo from Dennis Freeman to Rick Reed.
Second.
Moved by Carolyn, seconded by Margot. So the motion includes the new price structure in the memo.
In the memo.
That's the...
Yes.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, 500.
I'm glad we're doing it.
Our hope is that these will last for 100 years. Sure.
So my name is Diane Hughes, and it's my intent that my husband's buried in this new area. So I just want to say thank you to the DPW and to Dennis for having, for creating this new area that I anticipate will be really tranquil and park-like. And it's where my sons will visit their father for the rest of their lives. So I thank you, and I particularly want to thank Caroline, because what started as a conversation between friends over Thanksgiving is the reason we're here today. And I'm so grateful to you. So thank you.
Thanks for saying that.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much, all of you.
Shawshing Cemetery was, as Don Corey incessantly reminds us, was modeled after Mount Auburn Cemetery in its original structure. And I think David and Dennis and all connected with it, keep that in mind when and take their responsibility very seriously. So glad you feel that way, too.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for coming.
You're welcome to stay for the review of the capital expenditures.
Floor show to follow.
And you've got other stuff coming up, right? So might as well stay for this because it's going to come out the same. We have Mr. Battaglia, Mr. O'Neill, any other members?
Right here.
Our own veteran delegate. How many years is this for you, Bill?
Sorry?
How many years is this for you as with capital expenditure?
I think six.
And Mark was before you.
Yeah, I noticed how fast he handed it off.
So I keep looking for the line. Where's the line? The famous line is, it's not here. Any words of introduction, history?
I'm sorry. The town of Bedford bylaws require the capital expenditure committee to provide the selectmen annually their recommended capital projects plan. It's a six-year plan, and technically it's supposed to be submitted 10 working days prior to the end of the fiscal year. So with the inclusion in the package this past Friday, then the capital expenditure committee did meet its goal and under the bylaw this year. So Mr. Battaglia, who's the chairman this year, is here to give you an overview of the recommendations of the committee. And you have in your package a comprehensive spreadsheet which shows all the projects. I did, it was pointed out to me earlier tonight that there's probably a formula. I was just getting up to tell the assistant city manager or town manager about this, but there's a formula error in the cumulative column that doesn't seem to count the cumulative dollar amount. Is it?
The version
it's
that we
not the version we have.
They don't have that.
Yeah. There's no way to be able to make sense of the math of the ongoing cumulative projects.
What do you, do you mind if I look at your copy?
Sure. Sure.
I mean, if some of the numbers actually get reduced, but even some of the simple, when the math adds, it doesn't add. So there's something going on with the formula where sometimes it's working and sometimes it isn't.
That lines got inserted and then the formula wasn't carried over or something.
I guess that explains why there is no line.
Yeah.
Made a wrong.
Oh,
While they're doing that, can you describe the process we went through and...
Yeah, please.
You know, let the session begin. So, anyway, appreciate your time here tonight. The way the FY, and I don't know if you're familiar with how the cap, if you're already on the committee and you're on the committee, how the Capital Expenditure Committee functions, but this year we had the various town departments present their six-year plans over the course of October, November. Each project had a questionnaire. There were roughly 10 questions on this questionnaire that provided different aspects of information that allowed us to make a better assessment of the project, such as ROI type of calculations, purpose behind it, is it shovel ready, different questions along those lines. In addition to the presentations, there were liaisons that visited each of the capital, each of the departments to understand what the projects were for that particular department, such that when the presentation took place, the liaison could provide any additional information from their perspective over what took place, as well as several members visiting various key projects that could be understood how they were actually functioning and what could be done with it. We finished our review last week. We made each one of the members assigned a ranking of 0 to 3. Prior to the ranking, we voted which projects we thought should be omitted from this year's program. And there, so you can see down on the bottom of the sheet, there were several projects that were omitted from our vote, and one was requested to move into FY19 based upon some of the probing that the committee had over its project in relation to another project. The vote was such that all these 44 projects here were approved by the committee. There were two projects that had a dissenting vote, and I'll discuss those in the course of our session. I'm assuming that all the numbers add up according to you said something earlier regarding how they're not adding, but
the cumulative column as you run down from project to project, there's, I think what's happened is we disrupted the spreadsheet probably by removing or moving around some projects, and so what happened is references that in the spreadsheet formula that go back to
so that's not there.
Right. And that's all that happened.
Right, bottom between
line
12 and 13
is still correct. $2.3 million is the correct number.
Okay. So just for comparison's sake, FY17, the 2353 compares to last year a spend of 2363. And the total capital expenditure of the $7.9 million compared to last year was $12.9 million. So there's an objective in the community, I believe, to have an increase from capital from one year to the next, roughly 3.5%, but that did not necessarily occur in this year's process. Anyway, I'm not sure how you would like to proceed if you want to go project by project. What I will describe is we have these 44 here below the line. There was the Lantern Lane, which was requested to move forward into FY19. The skate park rehabilitation, there really wasn't a compelling presentation in that discussion. It sort of seemed indifferent, so we decided that as a committee that we would not have that in this year's plan. The recreation grounds rehabilitation was felt that it was still in pretty good condition through several observations. And in addition, as we begin to probe it, that particular capital group decided to move it to FY21. And then the final one, the heating system for the fire station, although it probably under normal circumstances may have been approved, who knows, but given the fact we're uncertain of what the current status is with the fire station, we were, as a committee, wanted to ensure that we're, you know, not putting funds into the facility if it's not absolutely necessary, given the fact that there's a chance that it might be
replaced.
Can I ask a question at that, on that point? Obviously, you know, the need and the challenges in the fire station are something that we understand quite well, but the solution and the pathway forward is uncertain. And so I guess I just would ask what the committee's perspective is on systems that might fail or be near failure in the short term if we don't yet have a timeline to a successful conclusion of a new project, seeing as it would acquiring land, raising funds, and design, and all those things take a fair amount of time. So you're talking about several years where, so if there's a request this year for heating system, that request, you might see that request again next year. And sort of what will, in the mindset of the committee, what will have to change for them to feel as though something is so serious and the timeline is so uncertain that you will go ahead and fund something, even though you are taking a risk, right, that you're going to abandon that building before the lifespan of whatever that item is?
So you'll find in this plan there are several projects that are of a similar nature that seem to be they need to be replaced, and that the repair history behind it justifies it. And it may be difficult for some of them to be easily turned around to get replaced. The repair history in this particular circumstance didn't really seem to warrant it just yet. So we said we should just really monitor it over the course of this winter and see what takes place. And if it's determined that next year we should do it, then we may, you know, we may have to do that. We also were uncertain of what the real status was of the fire station. And so, by next year's election, if there, the review process, if there's still no determination, then, you know, then we may have a different opinion.
But
also, if extreme circumstance should occur, right, such that we can't get to voting, believe it or not, you can rent a boiler.
Sure, I understand, but I mean, it's one of those things, you don't want your fire station to be without heat.
Of course not.
I mean, discussions with the fire chief, it was this was presented by the facilities team. Mm. The fire chief felt that he did not believe it was an absolute necessary requirement just yet.
So, but we'll
followed his lead as well.
Did the board want to go over this project by project, or limit your questions to specific items on the list?
Well, maybe you'd like to discuss the one thing about Lane School and the.
There were two key projects here that had some debate amongst the committee, and one where I said there was one dissenting vote, and that was the project number, Lane School parking flow.
It's 23.
No, it's.
It's ranked 28. Yeah, it's item number 23, ranked 28.
Yes, exactly. Item number 23.
The parking lot.
Item numbers don't help much if they're not numerical.
Right. Good point.
So anyway, that particular project, there was some debate over would the parking, additional parking spaces be required. Several observations seemed to indicate that there were open parking spaces at different times during the course of the day. But the way the discussion really sort of roamed is if in fact the school is expanding, there's going to be additional staff. And because of the additional staff, the parking spaces would be required. But most importantly, the traffic flow during drop-off and pickup is really sort of a major concern of everyone in the committee that had those observations. So that was one that there was some, you know, discussion over, but the committee in the end decided to move forward with. The other was the water meter replacement program. The last item, number 44, that project is one where
there was discussion over the repair rate associated with the meters. They seem to be climbing as it stands now. Our most recent information was such that it was, I think it was 120 to 140 repaired in the last year. It's now, there's not enough funds budgeted for those meters. In addition, the cost effectiveness to doing it all at once was better than doing it on a piecemeal basis if we tried to do it over the course of 2 to 3 years. And there was just a general opinion that, you know, we really should have a common system and have some equity in the community. Everyone has a similar meter, and some people are not having different meter rates, meter readings, you know, whether they're operating or not. So in the end, we decided to move forward with this as well.
Was there ever any effort to calculate a payback in terms of the assumption that there's some lost revenue here on defective meter?
There was, there were several discussions over that. I could let maybe Victor might want to chime in, but.
Sure. So the lost revenue isn't really more or less lost revenue, but I think it's inequity amongst the users of the system. You have people that have 25, 30-year-old meters we find that most of those meters are measuring inaccurately, slow, and then you have people with newer meters who are measuring accurately. So what you have is you have people that are paying the usage for those people that for those meters that are measuring inaccurately. So the question came up was, we showed a projected increase in the rate over the next 5 years, and assume that the increase would be about 22 to 25%. When we projected that out, we used the average increase in our water and sewer purchase. We used what we assumed to be the debt, and we used an average increase in salaries and benefits. But what we didn't do was we didn't increase the consumption. If we were to increase the consumption, because now we have meters that are measured more accurately, you're going to find that that rate increase is going to be less, because now you're going to be able to measure a higher rate of usage in the system. It's not necessarily going to bring in extra revenue. What it's going to do is it's going to accurately calculate the usage, and there'll be equity across the system for all the users.
Thanks, Victor. Now, are there other questions about specific line items?
One other item, I believe number 20, which is space modification at Davis, and number 12, which is additional schematic design at Davis, are connected. Maybe you'd like
yes.
to say so.
So, based upon how the vote would be conducted, if number 8 is approved, then number 30 would not necessarily need to be performed, mm-hmm. and so that project would then come off the list. And vice versa. If it isn't approved, then those modifications would have to be performed. If it's approved, there still would be some work that needs to be performed, but the facilities team would be handling some of that minor work. It wouldn't require as much materials and movement of items.
Wanted to ask Mr. Mnookin about the water tank rehab. This is another water bond ranked 10, so it's up there. This isn't Pine Hill Road, is it? Or is it?
The water tank rehab, $818,000.
Yeah.
That's to focus primarily on the interior of the tanks.
Yeah.
So we've been working on the outsides.
Oh, so this is all three of them?
All three of them.
Oh, okay. How often is that necessary?
I don't know. I would say periodically. What we want to do is, over time, while water quality stays high, the interior of the tank has a tendency to draw some, it's called a biofilm, if you will, and it's an organic substance that over time increases, and we have to deal with it by counteracting it with treatment, more treatment, if you will. So eventually you get to a point where a physical process of scraping and just cleaning the tank mm-hmm. is more cost effective than treatment of the water. And we're at that point now in the system.
And my notes also have, I think there's could be potential like ladders and what have you. There's any
that's
rust,
right, yep.
There's mm-hmm. other outside equipment that could potentially be
and we have mixers on all of the water tanks now to circulate the columns, and then we've also done things like we've done injections when it needs to be amped up, essentially.
Yes, exactly. That's exactly it.
Okay.
Other line items that engender any questions? There's one down near the bottom for athletic field fencing. Any idea what field we're talking about?
So it's around the tennis courts, the football field. But this is, from my understanding, I've been on the committee a couple of years, but I guess this has been a recurring.
I was going to say it sounds familiar.
It's around the B field to allow separation of operation.
Oh, so that's new?
Yes.
Oh, that's interesting.
The tennis courts as well.
Yeah,
that too.
That's contiguous to Beefield.
Well, sir.
Thanks. Are they going to? They're not going to. They're not going to surround it, I hope.
No, but apparently there are athletic endeavors that go on in that area. That if balls go from one place to another, it interrupts.
Well, it goes into the swamp.
Well, there's that too.
There's that too. Yeah.
So this is to.
That's called home field advantage.
Separate activities.
I would point out another, we talked about the fire station earlier, the gutters and downspouts is one where we were hoping that maybe we could have it presented to the Historic Commission as to, instead of using copper at this stage until we know what happens to the fire station, to use a lesser expensive type of material. So that's another item on here related to the fire station.
I thought that would probably work.
Aluminum instead of copper.
Just at least for the moment.
It's a real hazard. Like right now, I'm sure there's probably some ice buildup because where it leaks. When I was the liaison for that last year, and when I visited, I did see the ice buildup, and so it can be a hazard. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Any other questions or comments? I want to thank the committee for its hard work and for making this so comprehensive an experience. I don't think there's any action required by us at this time.
No, I think at the staff level, what we'll be doing now is beginning to work on drafting the capital article for the annual town meeting warrant, and also work with the committee on the draft of the report of the capital expenditure committee.
Also, I'd like to add on behalf of the committee and actually on behalf of the town, a lot of hard work went in by staff to get to this level, and I think our committee is truly appreciative of how much self editing they did before we saw it, and so you're seeing a very collaborative effort here and a severely reduced a lot more trust going around in terms of if we ask for it, it's a legitimate ask, it's not just something on a want list, and so it's been terrific.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, it's very gratifying to see the process work. And just in case you're counting, town meeting is exactly 14 weeks away. That's less than 100 days.
Oh, dear.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Tony. I wanted to invite, I think, Mr. Manoogian back to talk about the NWRA water system plans for upgrade. They call it redundancy. This is something that's not going to affect us physically, but financially, right?
Basically, yes, that's it. So the Massachusetts Water Resources Authority is continuing to look long-term to develop redundancy in its infrastructure. And so they've done an analysis of their system from the Quabbin Reservoir into the city of Boston to see where they have weak areas, I guess you'd say. Areas where if tunnels had to be taken down for maintenance or there was significant damage for some reason, their backup system is not very resilient. And so they're looking for ways to develop a more resilient system and try to have complete redundancy, if you will, throughout the entire system, such that they could take a tunnel offline to do longer-term maintenance on it without disrupting the water supply to the greater Boston area. So the last area in their system that doesn't have the type of redundancy they're looking for is between Newton and Boston. And there's a number of tunnels that spread out from the Chestnut Hill area to north of the city and then into the city and just south into Dorchester. And so this project here is providing redundancy to those tunnels. Currently, we are connected to a secondary tunnel called the Weston Aqueduct Sewer, not sewer, Service Main number 3, Supply Main, Weston Aqueduct Supply Main, which basically is a medium-sized tunnel that connects the larger tunnels. If the larger tunnel or the Weston Aqueduct Supply Main 3 had to be taken offline, us, Bedford, and the communities around Bedford that have MWRA water would be limited as to the water supply it could have. And so while we would have the reservoir, the pond reservoir to back us up, that wouldn't be adequate for long-term repair, and the water quality is such that we would need to have a boil order and we'd be under significant risk. So MWRA is the first to acknowledge this is a low probability event. However, the consequences of it are very high. And so they've proposed this as a priority moving forward. It's a very large project. It'd take a number of years to be completed. And they are looking for approval from the advisory board. And Bedford is a member of the advisory board. And we felt it appropriate to, we wanted to notify the selectmen of this project. The Public Works feels that it is a worthwhile project to continue to develop redundancy in the system.
Margaret?
Is Spot Pond one of the reservoirs that is dry currently?
Spot Pond is not in great shape, you're absolutely right.
In Stoner?
I think it is up in,
I don't think it's in Stoner. I don't remember which.
Off 93.
Off of 93, yeah.
Stoner Melrose?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Malt has that area.
Well, it's just, you know, if the backup plan for this low likelihood event is using one of the reservoirs, and if you've taken a look at the reservoirs lately that are completely empty, it seems to me that that's something that we definitely want to avoid.
The $60 to $65 per year per customer that appears on here is, I assume, would be folded into the MWRA water rate, and it would be just to these towns that are being served on by this tunnel, not system-wide?
That's a great question. It was a question with a lot of discussion, and it is system-wide.
It'll be system-wide.
The feeling is that it's a whole system, and people pay for improvements over the entire system.
Mm-hmm.
It's a loop system. Redundancy in a water system, broadly speaking, can benefit everybody. So the costs are spread out amongst all members.
I assume this would all be bonded so that $60, $65 per customer is like a 20-year situation.
Exactly.
Yeah, that answers my question, because $60 to $65, although it's, you know, for a ratepayer, that's significant in the context of the size of the project that was being described, that didn't seem as much as I thought it would be. So the answer is, it's because all the MWRA communities are all paying that.
Exactly. Okay. And in addition, what the advisory board is recommending, that the MWRA periodically has special deals with municipalities. So for example, Worcester has periodically purchased raw water that they then treat themselves. And so that wasn't part of the MWRA's plan to sell that water. It's kind of extra money. So we're recommending that that extra money be set aside and put towards this project to help offset the rates for everybody.
It's extra money, but it's less water for everybody else. I'm always glad to see it raining these days.
Do we anticipate that the MWRA is going to issue any new guidelines about water conservation? I know this is a subject that, you know, we have some correspondence about from the Board of Health, and also just conversation with residents, people are confused why Bedford doesn't have restrictions while our neighboring towns do, and you can explain that. Many of our neighboring towns are on well water, and we are primarily MWRA, and with it only being at 85%, I mean, being 85% capacity, it hasn't fallen to the point in the Quabbin where they're issuing any mandatory notification, but are there going to be any new guidelines or any new opportunities to educate property owners about water conservation given the scale of the regional drought?
I think the education that you mentioned is the key area that they're going to start to focus on. In November, it did dip below normal range in the reservoir to slightly below normal, I think down to 79%. Even in that range, they don't have mandatory restrictions that they start to put in place. So it's an education process to learn about the idea, the concept that a drought is not a one-season event, it's not a month event. It can happen over a number of years. Ongoing weather patterns can affect it in different ways. And so that part, I think, is part of the education focus that moving forward, absolutely, they're interested in letting people know about.
Any other questions on the MWRA plans?
So is the purpose of this simply to advise us, or are you asking us to take a vote in support of these four aspects of the approval that the advisory board is seeking from its
members? Well, I think public director is the representative on the advisory board, but we just felt that because of the economic impact that this would have long term, that you should know that we would be planning to vote in favor of this before we go ahead and do it. So unless you have any serious concerns, I think that's what Mr. Manoogian planned to do when this is scheduled at the advisory.
Certainly sounds like the right way.
I think our serious concern is that the well is dry, the pond.
Yeah. Well, if, I mean, God forbid, if we needed to supplement, we'd probably go to Burlington before we worried about Spot Pond. That's what we've always done before.
Although it said here that Burlington is one of the communities that receives some water from MWRA. Mm. I didn't realize that. So they're not completely independent. Mm. So even they would be somewhat impacted by that, I'd imagine. So, you know, if they're being squeezed for water, they may not be in a position to sell us as much as we might need.
You know, we also have connections had connections with Concord and Billerica. When we closed the wells in the late 70s, we were looking everywhere. So now, on a lighter note, we ask you to talk about proposed unique sign indicating the location of our seasonal storage facility.
So, in this, we're bringing this to you because the selectmen, under the sign bylaw, have the authority to approve public access signs. There really is no signage at the seasonal storage facility, and this is an idea that the DBW staff is proposing for helping to identify the location. You have a picture in your package of a snowplow blade that is out of service that could be used for this purpose, and it's depicted in a graph form, graphical form of what it would look like out at the entrance to the site.
There's a movable freestanding sign? Immovable?
I don't think it's too movable unless you have a giant truck.
Well, you remember the one that popped up like this at the entrance to where Bedford Auto? Yes.
And they were told to get rid of it. I would think the same thing would apply to the town.
Well, I think this is definitely a different situation. I mean, that's definitely a commercial utilization and on private property, so I think it's not a public access sign in that case. The sign bylaw has a provision that allows a selectman pretty much broad latitude with respect to public access signs. So
I mean, I can understand it's sort of a novelty idea, but is there any particular reason why just a regular sign like we put anywhere isn't the way that we would go with this, other than the fact that you have this
plow?
We were cleaning up 108 Carlisle, and we found this in the woods. It's an older piece of equipment. It's an antique, if you will, from our point of view. It was a project that the guys basically just got excited about. For a relatively small cost to put this back together, they figured they could restore something that was used quite a bit in the past and make it a useful sign, basically.
Second. My thought is that area out there is essentially residential. It's zoned residential. And we need to respect the neighborhood out there. I also happened to look at the sign bylaw, and the purpose, number B here, is to encourage signs that are aesthetically pleasing, which are harmonious with both the buildings and sites where they are displayed and their larger environs, and which are in keeping with the general atmosphere of the town. And I would say that I don't think that this is in keeping with the town. We do have these signs around here. These are attractive. They also are not huge. Even if for a commercial operation, the sign isn't supposed to be bigger than 5 by 6, 30 square feet. This sign would be bigger than that. So if this were in the HDC, this is what we would say you should be putting in there. I think this is in keeping with the town. It's the signage we use here. I appreciate the enthusiasm of your members, and I understand why they would do that, but I just don't think that's the sign for that location. And would recommend this.
Carolyn?
I can go either way, but I'll just say that we have a property up in New Hampshire, and we have the DPW in that town has this exact same thing, and it looks great, and it's in a part of town that is similar to where this is. I understand the sign bylaw, and I understand what your point is, but I would not call this highly residential. I think that it's a unique entrance to a DPW storage facility. I could go either way, but I wouldn't want to just rule it out because it doesn't match the other signs in town, and it's next to a neighborhood. I kind of like the idea, but I'm sure I'll be alone in that.
Other comments? There's nobody across the street. There's a house contiguous on the other side of Winterberry. Mm-hmm. What's the proposed placement near in relation to the entrance?
As you face the entrance, to be on the right side.
Is there any consideration of a different color?
Absolutely. We'd be happy to work with the board, the selectmen, to, if there's a more appropriate color.
The color's kind of shocking, at least on my copy. Mr. O'Neill?
As you might guess, I have some opinions. I think it's insulting to all the people that are businesses and residents who you're asking to conform to some sort of standard. The same reasons you're discussing here were the ones that were used by
people to respect the objectives of the town. And the only one that's allowed to violate this aesthetics and sensibility is the town itself. I think it's insulting to me, and it's insulting to a lot of people. And there's actually no reason that George has a sign that says town dump seems to be correctly added to it.
Thank you. Of course, there is an appellate avenue open to many applicants whose original proposals don't meet bylaw, and they have the opportunity to get a variance.
They don't.
I mean, I wonder if that's...
No, they don't, Mike. There's
no variance.
I mean, in terms of things like illumination.
They're very strict guidelines within the bylaw. There's no variability within the lighting is to satisfy the 30 square feet is there, and nobody would be allowed to have this for any reason. Mm. It's a very strict bylaw.
Other comments?
Well, I'll just... I guess I'll just say I'm not in favor of it.
Plan B.
I realize it wouldn't accomplish the same thing, but what if you located it inside the compound?
I think that we enjoy the piece of equipment, and certainly we want to abide by the decisions and can appreciate the concerns of the town, so we try to find another use for it.
Yeah, I mean, I appreciate the creativity too, the concerns make sense as well. There's plenty of room when you enter. There are fewer and fewer people who remember when it was an active town dump, but still a pretty convenient nickname.
Well, we don't refer to it as the town.
Right, right.
It's not a town dump.
It's a seasonal storage facility.
Much more euphemistic.
Not even a landfill anymore.
The SSF.
Anyone want to make a motion? Or, I mean, if you don't make a motion, there's no...
I move they go back to the drawing board.
All right, well, it's probably the best thing is to move forward without a motion. And appreciate the conversation.
But congratulate them on their creativity.
Thank you.
Maybe we can have it in the Bedford Day Parade.
Oh, gosh, she said that out loud.
Wheels, then it becomes a normal thing.
All right.
We need a license renewal that we had postponed.
I move selectmen approve the 2017 common victuals license for Unigon LLC doing business as Prince Street Cafe.
Second.
Moved by Margaret, seconded by Caroline to renew the license. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 500. Have we heard from, there was one other restaurant that we were waiting to hear from?
Chipotle?
Mm-hmm.
No.
So is it just their alcohol license that is in question, or their common victuals as well?
You renewed their common victuals.
Oh, right. Just as, right.
So we're just waiting.
It's just their alcohol license.
Yeah.
Right.
We have a temporary sign permit request.
So how many are they requesting?
So this is a little bit unusual. We did describe to the applicant the policy generally, and they asked that we bring forward their request to the selectmen. So they're looking for signage at three locations rather than the two that the selectmen ordinarily have for a policy. Also, they're looking for a period of time from January 9th through February 27th, so that's roughly 7 or 8 weeks.
My only question, and maybe we don't know this answer, but there's a big gap between when the signs come down and the event is. Am I wrong? So they want to just...
Like 3 weeks?
But I'm not sure why, what they're the ones...
Well, it just seemed to me that if you were advertising something, it would lead up to the day of the event.
Well, I think they have to receive the information...
Prior?
Prior, yeah.
It's not...
It's an awfully long time to have that sandwich board sitting out in front of the police department.
Yeah, I agree. I agree.
I mean, I feel like it's important and, you know, obviously trying to reach people on whatever avenues are available to them. There are other ways other than signs.
Yes.
It's hard to believe that kindergarten registration is dependent on people driving by a sign on the side of the road reminding them that it's time to register their child for kindergarten.
Right, it's, I think it's fine within the normal scope.
Doesn't make any sense to me at all.
Is this in response to frequent underestimates of kindergarten enrollment? Are they just looking for other ways to try to reach out?
I sort of wondered that as well. I mean, I know that there have been surprise class sizes at the beginning of the year, and presumably if someone has failed to enroll, that's not a cause of in advance.
Right. So this
that's
is
not
an,
a cause to turn them away, and this may be one of their attempts
to be more proactive.
Right, to make
my
that.
Perception is that's people moving into town and bringing kindergartners, not people who live in town and wait to the last second and then suddenly realize that they've not registered their child for kindergarten, and all of a sudden the enrollment goes up.
Right. Well, those are the known children. It's the new coming in, right?
Right. But the new ones,
so,
again, I'm not sure they're driving right. through town and being reminded in March that they need to register for kindergarten. I don't. It just seems odd to me, but.
So two signs, DPW and police station are fine. What what dates are?
Can we cut down the? This.
What's
do they
normal?
Need an answer
2 weeks
tonight because.
Can we figure out whether there's some process problem that we have here?
And also, if we wanted it to be for a shorter period of time, I'd rather leave it up to them to decide what that period of time is.
Sure.
For us to guess.
Right.
So tell them 2, and not 7 weeks, and see what they come back with.
Well, why don't? That's fine. Except, why don't you say what you're willing to approve from a week standpoint, then we'll ask them to select the weeks.
What's normal, a couple of weeks?
I mean, we could put them up 2 weeks.
The normal policy that I'm allowed to sign off on that the selectmen have is 1 week prior to the event and 2 signs at 2 of the 3 locations.
And we've gone 2 weeks with the Boy Scouts.
Yeah, but I almost wonder if they wanted to have 2 weeks and then a hiatus and then another 2 weeks. And that would get them the span that they would need, and we would just need to approve it twice for 2 two-week periods, rather than 7 weeks all told. They'd still have the signs out at the beginning and the end of the time period that they wanted, but not have it be there continuously. I mean, it just seems like there'll be other organizations asking to put up signs, and there's just going to be a lot of signs there.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to know what the rationale is for the request, and might be some circumstances that we didn't think of, although it's a long time.
Yeah,
it's going to become part of the landscape, and nobody.
It's just very ambitious.
And not to mention, it's probably going to snow.
Are they also looking for March for those 5 days?
No,
just the period from the 9th of January to the 27th.
But what's the March 20th?
That's the actual registration.
That's the registration.
Oh.
So it's preempting those dates.
Is that enough feedback?
Yes.
Ready for the minutes? Chronologically, November 21.
I had a couple things. On page 3, second paragraph, that starts Ms. Fleischman, I suggested that BARC include in the policy a section that would deter the cutting of public street trees by developers during construction and to make adequate restitution to the town if they had to remove mature trees. And then another one on page 5. Just at the very bottom. In open discussion, my second paragraph, I would just say at the very end, reaffirm that Bedford is a community that welcomes people regardless of religion, ethnicity, or country of origin. That's it.
March, November 21, other corrections?
I don't have any.
Mike, just one on the last page again, on actually the very last paragraph, just either I'm not seeking reelection in March or in the March election.
In the March.
Doesn't matter to me, but in the March.
It's like Mao. The Great March.
In the March, the Great March.
I have a couple, beginning on page 2, just past the middle, Bedford Babe Ruth Youth Baseball did not want to sign a 2.5-year lease. I want to just add after lease, comma, because it would expire in the middle of the baseball season.
Right.
I don't want them to sound recalcitrant. At the very bottom of the page, the first request is add the words for BARC to develop a comprehensive policy. On page 3, third paragraph, Ms. Edwards reported that the Almost Free Street Tree Project, I want to put some hyphens in there, between almost and free, and between street and trees. So it makes sense, Almost Free Street Tree.
I think also that they, that's the sort of the name of the program.
Cap, initial caps.
You want street tree project capitalized?
Yeah, almost free.
All the words.
Street tree, and then project could, yeah.
And finally, two paragraphs from the bottom of 3, Chair Rosenberg asked if the insert Middlesex, if the insert contaminated Middlesex Turnpike wells. Ready for the motion?
I move that we accept the minutes of Monday, November 21st as amended.
Second.
Moved by Margaret, seconded by Mark. All those in favor of 21.
Aye.
Aye.
500, December 5.
I have a few things on page 3. Third paragraph from the bottom, where we're talking about Ralph Hammond. Last sentence, I would just like to change it to, Ms. Fleischman suggested that the selectmen consider appointing Mr. Hammond at this December 19th meeting, but did not think it was necessary for him to be re-interviewed.
But that didn't make it onto the warrant. I mean, onto the...
Yeah, I'm noticing that now.
Town manager's report.
Oui. There's a new application.
Next meeting?
Yeah. Next meeting. But that's what it should say in the minutes. And then I have another correction at the bottom of the following paragraph. What National Grid is doing to address gas leaks in the town and their accelerated gas main replacement program, not gas meter. That's it.
Anybody else? I move that we accept the minutes as amended for Monday, December 5th.
Second.
Moved by Bill, seconded by Caroline. All those in favor, as amended, all those in favor.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. 500, December 8th.
I move we accept the minutes of Thursday, December 8th.
Second.
All right, moved by Bill, seconded by Margot. December 8th is written. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. 500, town manager's report. Look, we're ahead. Incredible.
No pressure, though.
You mean you want me to slow you down? Let's see. sorry, hold on. Oh, okay. So tonight we wanted to just talk to you a little bit about a planned fire engine purchase that we're about to make. Town meeting did appropriate $564,515 for the replacement of a 2003 fire engine under Project 17-30. The department has been working since annual town meeting, to work on the specifications for the vehicle. And they finalized all of that work. They are now ready to place an order. We're planning to purchase this under a regional purchasing contract through the MAPC. And because of it being a cooperative purchase, it doesn't require a contract to be on the selectmen's agenda to be approved. But I just thought that, knowing that it's a $564,000 truck, we'd like to just hear
what's happening
about it before we process the order. So we've included in the package a memo from Chief Grunes just describing the process that the department went through, and also drawings of the vehicle and the listing of a general description that's been, or proposal that's been made by the regional vendor that's authorized to sell the vehicle. That's Greenwood Emergency Vehicle Services, Greenwood Emergency Vehicles LLC from North Attleboro.
Rick, they mentioned in the memo change technology. Are you aware of what they're referring to?
Change technology?
Well, the technologies have changed since 2003. You know, it's not a big deal. I was just curious.
I don't have a specific example. I mean, it's just general overall, like everything else. There's a lot of controls and, you know, electronics that operate on a fire truck, and just like they advance in computerization, they advance also in the vehicles.
Okay.
So if you have no questions, we'll proceed with the purchase. And that's all I have to bring up tonight, except that we have an executive session scheduled after open discussion.
Thank you. Open discussion, Selectman Siegenthaler.
I am all set.
Selectman Fleischman.
I've got three little mini reports. Community Preservation met last week and has set a tentative date for our public hearing on January 31st, with another meeting in anticipation on January 18th. So we can take, as we just said with the regional housing situation, we can take proposals up until that time, and that'll get us done in time for closing the warrant in February. So just so that you're aware, if there's any interest or concern about anything coming before Community Preservation, we do have those two dates scheduled. Energy Task Force did have the guest from National Grid come talk about the gas leaks replacement program, and what they're trying to do is accelerate the rate at which they remove gas leak prone pipe in towns and cities. Bedford has several miles of this main that is prone to leaking, and has to do with the age, the materials that were used, and sort of the general condition based on those characteristics. And one of the things they're looking for from communities is allowing them to work year-round, and wanted Bedford to consider whether or not that might be something that, which we do not currently allow, that we might allow in the future to help this process go faster. So that was just one thing that I wanted to bring to your attention. I'm sure that staff will be talking about this as a matter of course anyway, but it was a very informative presentation, and we were very appreciative of National Grid sending two people to come and talk to residents, and it was well attended. And then finally, Transportation Advisory Committee, which happened to have met the same night as Energy Task Force, did vote to recommend that the selectmen place the adoption of the amendments to Chapter 90, allowing local change of speed limits, to be placed on the annual town meeting. So I know I brought that up in discussion in the past, that it was in the Municipal Modernization Bill that the governor signed, and that so Transportation Advisory Committee would like to see us consider placing the a necessary warrant article to adopt that change that then would allow us to reduce speed limits in certain locations.
So it wouldn't change anything, it would just open the door to?
No, it's just accepting the Mass General law at this point. And then there's other steps that you have to take in order to determine where would be an appropriate place for a safety zone, where you can go down as far as 20 miles an hour, but otherwise you would have the option of choosing a 25 mile per hour rather than a 30 mile an hour speed limit for areas that you controlled, which the Transportation Advisory Committee strongly supports.
It's going to be a good town meeting.
More signs.
Selectman Fidelli?
No more signs, just lower speed limits.
Just two small things. So Transportation Advisory Committee, the reason why Mr. Hammond's did not, I believe didn't come up, is because we have a new application that came in for that board to the Volunteer Coordinating Committee.
Subsequently
to that. And so I believe that they were just reaching back out to both applicants and possibly coming up on a future agenda. I don't know if that made it. And the Recreation Commission will be looking to give you an update on Springsbrook Park in the middle of January, hopefully. They're meeting on Thursday for a vote, and they're going to put a brief presentation together. And so although I know our agendas are probably very busy, I guess this is my warning that they would like to grab 15 minutes at some point, and we'll be asking you for that.
That could be enough.
Yeah, it's going to be a quick presentation. Yeah. That's all.
Finance Committee, you already know about the guidelines that they've established, 25%, 2.5%. What's a decimal point? What's a decimal point among friends?
Times are good.
2.5. And
be 35.
Then 3.5.
Around 3.5 for the schools. The other discussion that came up is we've been talking about water tonight, and the fact that the water that is used by the town is the single unitary user of water in town, and while everything's metered, it's not really monitored. And so at least some members of the finance committee would like to begin a process of somehow including in the budgetary process monitoring how much water is using, setting goals, and even trying to follow the selectman's lead in trying to encourage saving water. And that will mean reviewing athletic fields in particular and other places. But so that will be a coming discussion, I'm sure. End of report.
Just want to point out that the use of water at Sabrin Field is much lower than it used to.
Under your breath wasn't enough.
Want to ask the town manager, if you don't mind, what your thoughts are in terms of the medical marijuana, where we go from here in terms of assembling the whatever, however it's going to be composed.
So, I mean, where this will be a zoning bylaw change, it's principally being handled under the planning board and planning department. I think in the few discussions I've had with our planning director, I think that they're planning to set up some kind of a working group that would, come together and advise or make recommendations to the planning board. It may include some planning board members as part of the group. It would also be informed by a staff-based group that would, basically be department heads talking about what the town thinks, staff thinks from a point of view of, uses and locations. It's probably going to be a discussion between the police, the code enforcement director as the chief zoning officer, and myself, and maybe youth and family, maybe schools, I don't know. But the idea was that the staff would give input to the working group that's being created by the planning board to move towards a public hearing eventually on a proposed zoning bylaw amendment with the intent of having that a adopted at the November special town meeting next fall.
Just this year. Thank you. Like to entertain.
Can I ask you a question? So on a parallel path, of course, we also have the option under the recreational marijuana statute to consider whether or not we want to have a referendum in town, which would then focus us only on medical marijuana, or potentially anyway, or not. I just didn't know whether anybody had been thinking about that at all, and if there had been any discussion. I mean, I know we haven't discussed it, obviously. I mean,
correct.
But I figured I'd just put it out there because
I think we're waiting for direction from the select.
I figured you were. But I think it's probably something we should think about because.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we don't want it to get too close to the.
Agreed.
Some towns have already moved.
Some towns have already talked about having one, and it could be a way to focus us on one aspect as opposed to the other, or it could clarify for us as a community whether or not we're, you know, on board with either.
It's also not real clear yet whether the Massachusetts legislature is going to amend.
Change the law, right.
There's some thinking that that is going to happen, so mm-hmm. in a sense, acting too quickly on the recreational marijuana stuff is perhaps maybe not the best thing.
Right. Although I guess it depends on your perspective, and I'm not saying I have a perspective one way or the other, but it seems to me unlikely that the legislature is going to take away the ability of communities to say that they would prefer not to have recreational marijuana sold in their
community. But even the language, my understanding is that even the language that allows communities to vote to take it away is mm-hmm. not clearly written.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it might change.
Yes, exactly.
So I just figured we should be preparing ourselves to think about, I mean, unfortunately, or for better or for worse, we're now running on two parallel paths
mm-hmm.
because there's the existing medical marijuana statute and now the recreational marijuana statute. So,
one thing that, I mean, it sounds silly, but can anyone clarify why you need a medical marijuana law if you can buy recreational marijuana?
Well, those people who have medical marijuana cards still have them, and they haven't rescinded.
Yeah.
I mean,
But if you can buy it over the counter, why do you need to?
Well, especially right now, you can't. I mean, you still can't buy anything.
Now you can.
Yeah.
Right. So recreational marijuana is now decriminalized, but it's not legal to sell it. And medical marijuana is legal to sell.
Yeah, I understand that.
So up until the time.
I think you mean long term.
Right. But I mean, up until the time that they finish the laws about the Cannabis Control Board and get this up and running, you presume that people who have a medical marijuana card would still require access to that.
Yeah, for now, sure.
For now, right. And then
you're right. I mean,
after
bigger
that,
picture,
maybe
notwithstanding whatever the federal government's going to do, if ever anything.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you're right. I mean, you can buy it one place, you could buy it another place. But again, communities may feel that from a medical point of view, they're willing to have a medical facility, but not really interested in having general recreational. It's going to be complicated before it gets less complicated.
I've asked Ken Gordon to see if he can schedule some time with us at a January meeting, and that'll be one of the things that I've asked him to update us on. So soon I'll have the exact date. Entertain a motion to enter an executive session for the reason of discussion of contract negotiations, not to return to open.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Margot, seconded by Bill. All those in favor individually?
Aye.
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 Aye. 500. We'll wait for the broadcaster to disassemble.
Okay.
Thanks, Victor, for a good time away. I assume everything's in order for the mailing of the tax bills.
Hi, everybody.
No, I just have it in there.
What is that?
Bill.
Town manager.
Town